68, le conflit nord-irlandais, la guerre du Vietnam.
L'Institut Notre-Dame du Nil est destiné à former l'élite féminine du pays.
A backwards glance at one of photojournalism's leading lights, a linguistic thriller with a literary twist and a prescient account of school days in 1970s Rwanda. That's all coming up in today's film show. And for that, film critic Lisa Nesselson joins me. Hello, Lisa.
Hello, Olivia.
Well, we're starting off with something from documentary maker Marianne Otero. She's just released a new film about French photographer Gilles Caron, who took some of the most iconic photographs of the second half of the 20th century before vanishing while on assignment in Cambodia in 1970. Now, this film's called Histoire d'un regard in French, or perhaps Story of a Gaze in English. Mm-hmm. Tell us more.
Well, I heard a photojournalist describe Gilles Caron as a sort of James Dean of photographers. He had a brief but incandescent career, and his work lives on as powerful as it was when it was created. He covered the conditions in international hotspots for 6 intense years and died at just age 30. I personally didn't know his name, but like many people, I was definitely familiar with several of his photos from the Paris protests of May 1968, from the Six-Day War in Israel, and of French entertainers and politicians.
They are iconic indeed. Well, let's see whether a picture is worth a thousand words. Here's a clip.
J'ai voulu comprendre son parcours, sa manière de voir le monde. 6 années de reportage, 100 000 photos, 2590 planches contact, c'était elle qui allait pouvoir nous restituer quelque chose de son regard.
Ça, c'est vraiment quelque chose de très incroyable en lui, c'est que dans une pellicule de 36 vues, il y en a au moins 30 qui sont exploitables, quoi. C'est incroyable.
À travers son regard, Gilles Caron nous raconte l'histoire de son époque. Il nous raconte aussi son histoire.
So given that these are still photos, it's not the easiest thing to make into a film, really, and not an obvious topic. So how did the director structure her account of the work?
Well, she definitely manages it. The project started when a friend sent her a book of Caron's photos, and two things jumped out at her: that Caron had died at age 30, leaving two young daughters behind, and that her own mother had also died at age 30, leaving her and her young sister behind. Even more of an inspiration was the fact that the last roll of film known to have been shot by Caron has images on it of his two young daughters, and the last drawings her mother made were of her and her sister. Now, Otero goes to visit one of the now grown daughters and returns with every photo he ever took, digitized on a hard drive, and spent 6 months putting all those rolls of film in order and examining the before and after from published shots to intuit how he approached his work, where he situated himself before clicking the shutter.
Now, you mentioned those high-profile portraits of celebrities like Yves Montand, Catherine Deneuve, or James Brown. He also covered the war in Vietnam, the famine in Biafra, and the troubles in Northern Ireland, and he was, in fact, the only non-British photographer to be working there.
Yes, especially fascinating for me was how he reacted during the Six-Day War in 1967. Foreign photographers were put onto a bus, and she determines from his rolls of film that he just let the bus go off without him, and so he picked a spot in Old Jerusalem, and he had no idea what was actually going on, but he noticed Israeli soldiers arriving to kiss and touch this old wall, figured out it was the Western Wall, the also known as the Wailing Wall, and so Jews had not been anywhere near it since, say, 1948. So in more than one way, his photographic record is exceptional.
Those photos do endure, that's true. Well, next to a film named Our Lady of the Nile, which is set in Rwanda in 1973. Now, that was 20 years before the devastating inter-ethnic violence of the genocide in the 1990s. But in some ways, this gives us some context. Tell us more.
Well, Our Lady of the Nile is a boarding school for girls dedicated to training Rwanda's female elite, while also stuffing their heads with mostly hypocritical Catholic teachings transmitted by discipline-obsessed Europeans. The film signals the increasingly bold demonization of minority Tutsis by the Hutu population of Rwanda, fueling some deadly rampages 20 years before the full-blown genocide that made headlines in 1994. Featuring this marvelous ensemble cast of young women, it's an unusual history lesson laced with irrational but deadly violence.
Well, the film's director is also award-winning novelist Atiq Rahimi, and he told France 24 about what he took away from the making of this film. Let's hear from him.
I went there for 9 months, and I let myself be taken over by the imaginary, the dreams and the nightmares of a people.
Et voir comment une génération...
And see how a generation dreamt of a better life and how the church, colonialism and internal politics created a nightmare for this new generation, for these beautiful and kind young girls.
Où sort le cauchemar?
C'est qu'un homme la tue.
Diego!
Il faut fuir, Virginia.
Non, je ne fuirai pas.
Vous étiez des nobles, autrefois.
Otto, Tutsi, Otto. Moi, je comprends pas.
Now, Tutsis are routinely called cockroaches by the majority Hutus. Certain students are overly fixated on what shape a true Rwandan nose should be, and the very fact that the girl's supposedly flagrant physical differences are hard to tell apart is further proof of the stupidity, I think, of racial divisions.
Yeah, and apparently there's, you know, quite a lot of internalized racism there with them, but what about the level of the education at the school?
Ah, well, when one girl tells the priest that one of their teachers claims that man evolved from apes, the priest angrily dismisses such nonsense, and she says, well, that was exactly what she thought, because her grandfather told her that men came first, they got lost in the jungle, and then they turned into apes. And then there's the news from abroad that white people eat weird stuff like caviar and foie gras at every meal. Asked why they're studying French and Belgian kings of yore instead of Rwandan royalty, the nun explains that Africa is for geography, history is for Europe.
Right, and that's not too long ago, is it? It's quite shocking. Now, next to a French film with an impressive international cast, The Translators was inspired by the true story of language professionals who were more or less put under house arrest while translating a Dan Brown novel, Inferno, it was called, to prevent the text from leaking before publication. I love a bit of language drama. Now, this film is set up as a thriller. Does it work?
Not really, but I still kind of enjoyed it way more than I enjoyed The Da Vinci Code anyway. But I'll admit that because I've translated three books from French into English, I may just like the topic. The characters aren't really developed much beyond the Danish one, the Portuguese one, the Greek one, the Chinese one, etc. But the film at least puts in a good word for literary translators who tend up to end up working way more often on, you know, crassly commercial books as opposed to James Joyce or Proust. The pitch is fun. Publisher Eric Engstrom, played in devilishly nasty mode by Lambert Wilson, has bought the rights to the third volume of author Oscar Brock's much-awaited Daedalus trilogy, The Man Who Did Not Want to Die. Nine translators are summoned to a lavish manor in the middle of the French countryside, where they won't be able to leave for 2 months, working 6 days a week, 10 hours a day, to get those 480 pages translated from French. Phones and personal devices are confiscated, and scary Russian guards never far away. But somehow, the first 10 pages are stolen and appear on the internet with a hefty ransom demand, or else more of the book will be leaked.
Will be leaked and heads will presumably roll. Well, this could be a case of words being worth a thousand pictures with a few very well-known actors. Let's see if you can spot them.
Eric. Dario Farelli. Quel plaisir de vous rencontrer. Vous m'avez reconnu?
Oui, monsieur Farelli, vous comme tous les autres. Installez-vous, je vous prie. Installez-vous.
Oui.
Mais il n'y a que les 20 premières pages.
Je doute que vous ayez le temps de les traduire à la perfection en une après-midi. Bien, je viendrai récupérer les feuillets ce soir et vous les rapporterai demain avec les 20 suivants, si nécessaire, etc.
So I suppose you could describe it as a bit like Knives Out, given the mystery element here.
Well, a lot of people would call that comparison heresy, but they do both hearken to a very similar template. The Translators is also chock full of unexpected developments and late arriving revelations, people who aren't who you think they are, secret motivations, genuine and imagined dangers. There's a chase scene through Paris streets involving Line 6 of the metro. The writer-director's previous film was more accomplished, I think, populaire. Worth seeking out about competitive typing competitions. The script seems to have spent a fair amount of time on a trampoline because, boy, does it bounce around. The end result is silly, and I think I lost track of how many twists there are, but I still kind of had a good time. Guilty pleasure.
Shows you just how high the stakes are in translating. writing and interpreting, I must say. Now, finally, we're taking a look at a film festival here in France, which I know you love, in the city of Clermont-Ferrand, which is, in fact, the biggest event on earth devoted to short films.
Indeed, it is. For over 40 years, Clermont-Ferrand, which is about a four-hour train ride away from Paris, has been hosting a wildly popular and impressively extensive festival devoted exclusively to films that last less than 59 minutes, most of them much briefer. Many big names in French filmmaking, such as François Ozon or Mathieu Kassovitz, got their start there. It's a university town, very egalitarian, and roughly 25,000 students drop everything they're doing to go to programs of shorts from 9 in the morning until past midnight in over a dozen venues for 9 days straight. There are three separate competitions, French, International, and Labo for more experimental work, and they're very nicely endowed with cash prizes. The short film market features stands from dozens of countries because buyers on their way to the Berlin Film Festival are interested in short films. Really are big business.
They are certainly these days. Well, indeed, if you do fancy a trip to the picturesque destination of Clermont-Ferrand, the short film festival's running until February 9th. Lisa, thanks so much for bringing us that roundup this week. Do remember you can get more movie news on our website, and you can keep up with us on social media too. There's more news coming up on France 24 just after this.